All right, so welcome back to another one. It is dark outside, so I am standing because I do not want to sleep. Ignore that I'm standing. But today I'm just going to show you how I go about setting up a brand new MacBook Pro for software development. So either it's for work or for personal use, I kind of have the exact same workflow. It doesn't change too much. So without wasting too much time, let's just jump right into it. All right, so let's start with some specs. The MacBook I have today is fairly new. It is the M4 base model with 16 gigabytes of RAM and 512 gigabytes of storage. So nothing fancy. I would typically not get the base model. I would typically get, say, the Pro or the Max if I was going crazy. I don't know why I would do that, but if I wanted to. But to be honest, for a programming job, this will run just fine. If you're building, like, say, applications, you have a few Kubernetes pods you're running or anything like that, you don't have to worry too much. I wouldn't stress about it. It works perfectly fine. Now, for settings, I am not going to go through the entire onboarding flow just because it's extremely intuitive and there's no real reason for me to do that. But I will talk in a few key items very quickly. The absolute first thing I change is tap to click. I absolutely hate having to click all the way on my laptop. So even though I am typically working on my setup with my external keyboard, monitor, mouse, when I do work on my laptop, I like having that tap to click. So it's very nice. You should try it out if you haven't. I then go ahead and give myself the most basic wallpaper I can, because as I got older, I just like the more boring ones, to be honest with you. Then I toggle the show path bar and show status bar, just because it's great to see the breadcrumbs when I'm in directories, just so I know where I am and also know how much space and capacity I have left. And I swap out the clutter with apps I actually use, as you might already see. We're going to add some more apps down there in this process, but there's an imposter up in there, so I don't know if you can notice, but there's an imposter in there and we're going to get him up out of here right now. Now, the very next thing I do is that I open lovely Safari over here and I download a new browser. Yep. The browser I'm currently using is Arc. I used to use Chrome all the time and I still do use it. They are both Chromium based, so as a developer, the main reason to use either of them is because of the extensive developer tools, which I use a lot. So while developing, you're able to look at your source, your console, your network requests, and so much more, which is extremely important when debugging. I can't stress that enough. And Chromium browsers make that very intuitive. So why one over the other? To be honest, I just like Arc because it looks cooler. It looks cooler, it looks better in my opinion. I like that I don't have so many bookmarks everywhere. I like that the color scheme is nice, tabs are hidden, and it just has a nice feel to it. I actually enjoy looking at it and using it. So I've been using it for a few weeks now and I've been liking it so far. I still use Chrome here and there, but for the most part I just use Arc right now. So yeah, take Safari up out of there and put in Arc. App tiling, this one is quick. I use rectangle to tile my apps. So rather than dragging them and doing all this and that, I just use rectangle to set them in the right places. I'm able to put items in the center, make them bigger, make them smaller, put them to the left, right, middle, really anywhere you want to put them. But with all this customization, I still only have two screens on my Mac at once because I use shortcuts to switch a lot. Very underrated way. When I started using shortcuts to switch between windows, it's improved my workflow so much. So I use Command plus Tab to switch between apps, Command plus Backtick to switch between individual windows. Let's talk about something a little bit more exciting, the terminal. Now, the terminal is a place where a developer spends a lot of time, and sometimes all your time. If you don't like the terminal, you really need to learn to like it because it is literally your second home. But don't worry, I'm here to make it a little nicer for you. Now, I use the default terminal, but I also use Oh-My-Zsh to customize my terminal to look pretty cool. And I'm able to transfer my terminal from this to this. It supports plugins like autocomplete, syntax highlighting, and so much more. It makes your terminal experience so much better. And I always install this on the same day just because I don't hate the default terminal, but I love the extra customization that Oh-My-Zsh allows. But we're not done yet. If you've been working for a while, you will eventually have multiple terminals. So you might have one terminal for your application server, you have another one for your database server, you have another one for your Docker Compose file, and so much more. But rather than having like six terminals all over scattered and then you're trying to figure out which terminal is for which, you could just use a nice tool called Tmux. This is something else I always install. So what is Tmux? Tmux is basically a terminal multiplexer. What does that mean? You can have all those multiple terminals inside one. You don't need to be searching through screens to find a terminal. Just split the screen and get on with your day. Installing Tmux is easy, but you might get caught up because you can't use your mouse in the same way. Luckily, I have the script I saved and I just recycle it whenever I I reinstalled Tmux. I'll share it if you guys want to, just let me know in the comments. I'll like put it in like a link or something. But yeah, you can use this, and then you're able to use your mouse, you can copy text, and you can have multiple terminals in there. You have no idea how happy Tmux makes me, because before I would have like 7 different terminals and I'm just struggling to like figure out which one is which. But with Tmux, everything is just there. So I have one massive terminal, everything is in there. So now we have our terminal set up. We need a way to install packages, because we're developing on here, so we need to install packages. So that's where Homebrew comes in. Homebrew is basically a package manager for macOS. It's very useful for developers for installing CLIs, which means command line interfaces. A command line interface is basically how you interact with your computer or programs by typing in text commands into your terminal. So it's how you set up a new React project. It's how you set up a new Node.js project. It's how you check your Docker containers. It's how you set up connections with AWS and configure some AWS services. You do so much with CLIs. I literally start my day by pulling code from GitHub on the terminal and then pushing it back to GitHub on the terminal. So on the terminal with the CLI. Does that make sense? You're on the terminal, but you're using CLIs to interact with software. Homebrew, or Brew for short, helps me manage these CLIs, their versions and dependencies. That allows me to update them and so much more. And installing Brew is so easy. You just make a network request and it downloads the package and it installs it for you. So now that we have Brew installed, this is where things get a little dicey. Depending on what kind of technology you're working on, you might need to install different software or different CLIs to kind of work with that software. For instance, I work with Node and I also work with Golang. I work with Python here and there, but those are the two main things I work with. So I would install CLIs to help me work with Node, or JavaScript, TypeScript. I will also install CLIs to help me work with Golang, which is, I think, just one CLI, Go. But because the vast majority of developers use Node, I'm going to talk about Node. If you work on any kind of website, and to be honest, most servers at this point, you're going to need Node and NPM. Now, you can go ahead and install Node directly, but when you have a different project that uses a different version, you might need to go and start updating it, which is a hassle. So that's where NVM comes in. NVM stands for Node Version Manager, because Node has different versions. It's always being updated. So the current version of Node today will be different from the one next year. And the one next year might have different features that the one this year does not support. So you have different versions. So you need something that can manage those different versions for you, because different projects might use different versions. After this, the next step is to install Node and also to configure a default version of it. Because if you install Node through NVM and start using it, when you open a new terminal, you will need to set that up again, because you've not configured a default version for Node to use. And it's kind of annoying. On installing Node, you also get a version of NPM installed, which stands for Node Package Manager. So when you start building out your websites, your servers, you don't want to start developing everything from scratch, because some people have already done that before you and also done that better than you. A good example of this is DateTime by Luxon. It's a very comprehensive date and time library and my go-to for whenever I want to do with anything related to time manipulation or display. If you want to build this out yourself, it will first of all take you a lot of time. You might make mistakes and you'll probably end up making it reusable again just so that other people could use. There are a lot of kind-hearted people who have created open source projects that you and I can use in our applications, websites, servers, whatever you want. And DateTime is an example of that. So NPM allows you to download these projects and also allows you to manage their dependencies and their versions. Just make sure that you check before you download the library so you don't download the poor one, because these libraries can be very massive security risk. Like, I personally only download libraries that I actually really do not want to build out myself. And even when I download that, I like research the library and figure out like who the authors are and what the maintenance is looking like on this, because anyone can post anything to it. I can literally go and make a library today and post and it to be complete rubbish. So be careful with what you install. But also, don't build out things that are already built out if you can help it. So that really wraps it up for Node package management. So just as you would install Node for whatever you want to work on relating to JavaScript or TypeScript, if you're working with Golang like I do at work, you go ahead and also install the CLI for that. If you're working in Python, you install CLIs that will help you work on Python better, maybe something like Anaconda, Jupyter Notebooks, and the rest. All the code that we just downloaded was probably stored in a repository somewhere. In my career, the repository that I have used the most is GitHub. There are others, but for the most part, they work the exact same way. The best thing about this repository is that it tracks your version. So if you have a version 1 of some code, and you make a terrible mistake with version 2, it's no longer working. You can easily revert back to the previous commit, meaning that you revert back to the older version, and then you can start again from there. I'm not going to talk too much about GitHub in this video because that's a whole topic of its own. But what I do is that I set up an SSH key to communicate with my repositories and my work repositories. That's where I'm able to securely send code to GitHub and also retrieve code from GitHub, which allows collaboration with other team members and also version controlling for myself alone. We finally have a place to store code. We have the tools we need to edit code. We have our terminal. We just need to actually type in the code. And that's where our IDE comes in.
What does an IDE mean?
An IDE stands for an integrated development environment. Now, typically what I use is called Visual Studio Code, and it's not technically an IDE, it's more so like a code editor. But why I love Visual Studio Code is because you can really make it to be anything you want it to be because of its extensions. So while it might not act like a full IDE in the typical sense, it has debugger, it has integration with version control, it has so much. It's also very lightweight and I love the intelligent features. I just use VS Code. My work has massive repos and VS Code is able to handle it very easily and like map the entire thing together. So I love it. It gets absolutely no complaints from me. I do sometimes see that when I'm working on a lot, like if I have a lot of servers running at the exact same time, IntelliSense begins to kind of slow down. But I think that's more of a RAM problem than a VS Code problem. Let's quickly go over my current extensions. So I have Prettier. Absolutely love it. Always install it. It basically takes away ugly code and makes it look nice and well indented. You can also customize it massively so that you and your team can have the same format of code. GitLens simply shows you who put in that line of code, and then you can open the commits that make the code in, which is very useful in team environments and also useful for you if you're trying to see what version this came in. Go as well for Go. Spell checker, basically because I hate having to check my spelling and also hate seeing variables that have typos in them. So having spell checker just puts this blue squiggly line underneath a typo and points it out for you. And to do. I love to do tree because when working on massive things, you kind of want to leave little breadcrumbs to like kind of let you know what happened here, and then you can easily get back to it. So to do is a great one. I love it a lot. Just if you're using to do at work, just make sure not to commit it because no one else has to see that because you forgot to leave that in there. And that's it for VS Code. Absolutely love it. I'm currently developing a game app right now called Slowpacks, and this is where I'm at with the development. So loving the journey so far, it's going really good. But as you can see, this entire setup is what I use to develop this. At this point, you almost have every single thing you need. You could probably stop right here and you'll be okay. But there are a few apps to have, two very important ones that I will go through. First one of that being Postman. Postman is an application that allows you to get all sorts of API requests. You can make HTTP requests with REST or GraphQL, or you can make gRPC requests, and that's what I work with, so it's great to have. When working on backend servers, this is a must to communicate and debug. The best thing about Postman is how nice it is to use, and you can share entire documentation with other team members and also create your own documentations for whatever services you're working on, so it's absolutely amazing. This one is gutted. The very next one I will have is Beaver. So Beaver is just a database tool. Basically an IDE for databases. You're able to connect to the database, view the tables, make queries, and do so much against it. Very, very helpful to see your data as your backend manipulates it. Love this as well. So right now, every single thing we've spoken about, you're good. If you have these installed, you can basically develop almost every single thing you need. And then you can just install other things as it comes up. But then there are some other apps I also install depending on where I'm working or what I need to do. And they're not the most important ones, but let's talk about it. So Slack, I use Slack primarily for communication. I worked at places that use Microsoft Teams, and my question is just, why? Why use Microsoft Teams? Why do you do that? We also have Figma, and that's really just for looking at wireframes. And to be honest, I would not download this, but I was designing Slowpacks, and I wanted to have like some custom fonts. So I downloaded it so I could put in some custom fonts, and I put quotes over the design because I'm absolute shit at design. But that's how we got here. And then Notion. Now I use Notion a lot. I use Notion a lot. I love Notion, but I don't think you need to download it. Like if you have it on your website, like why are you downloading it? You could just open the browser and open Notion, but I don't know. Staying up to date with terminal commands can be tricky. But what's not tricky is staying up to date with your daily learning using Brilliant, the sponsor of today's video. Brilliant is a one-of-a-kind learning platform that helps you get smarter every day with thousands of interactive lessons in math, science, programming, data analysis, and AI. And they make mastering these concepts truly engaging. Instead of just watching videos, we'll dive into interactive problem solving, proven to be 6 times more effective for learning. With its first principles approach, Brilliant helps you understand ideas from the ground up. The platform keeps you motivated with a blend of thought-provoking challenges, a bit of friendly competition, and daily encouragement. Plus, every course is created by a top-tier team of educators and professionals from institutions like Stanford, MIT, companies like Microsoft and Google, and so much more. If you want to learn how to code and actually get it, Brilliant's updated programming courses are the perfect place to start. You'll build problem-solving skills that never go out of style, learn to think like a programmer by breaking down big problems into clean, simple code, and get hands-on experience with Python. And don't lock yourself into programming. Brilliant has so much to learn from. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for your full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/ugooko, or you can click on the link in the description or scan the QR code. You also get 20% off an annual premium subscription using this link. And a huge shout out to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. So yeah, that's really it and how I set up my MacBook for programming. You guys, let me know if I missed anything or if there's anything you would add or not use. But yeah, thanks for watching it and making it this far, and I'll catch you guys on the next one.